the clergy is holy.
Well, if you take your Bibles with me and turn to the book of Romans chapter 5. Romans and chapter 5. And verse 1. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. I want to read a few verses here before we start the message. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. Just give you a moment to find that. Romans 5 and verse 1. Okay, let's begin reading. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Today, my message is on freedom from guilt. Freedom from guilt. Believers in Christ often wrestle with discouragement and shame over past sins. I don't know if you ever heard of D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody was a famous preacher back in the 1800s. And he was visiting a prison in New York City called the Tombs. I don't know if you ever heard that term before, the Tombs. They called it, it was actually the Halls of Justice in Manhattan, New York. However, when they built the prison, it was built during the time of a revitalization of Egyptian architecture. So they said that when they saw the building, it looked like a Pharaoh's tomb, all right, Egyptian tomb. And that's why it got the name the Tombs. Now, it wasn't just because of the architecture, it was because of the fact that it was so notorious for being you wouldn't want to go there. Even a bad person wouldn't want to go there. It was a place of corruption. It wasn't a very nice place to be. And so it was called the Tombs for that. Well, D.L. Moody was there preaching to a group of people, and he was speaking to them. And then after the message, he wanted to go and interview some of the prisoners. And he went by different cells, and he said, "Why are you here?" He'd say to one prisoner, "Why are you here?" And one prisoner would say, "Well, I was falsely accused, and I'm innocent." And you go to another and says, "Well, I'm innocent, but my lawyer, he didn't do a good job. He didn't get me off." You go to another one, "Well, I was betrayed by a friend, and I'm innocent. I shouldn't be here." And it kind of was the same story over and over again, whoever he asked. However, he came to one man, and one man was in a cell, and he was obviously, you could tell, he was grieving. He was grieving over a certain thing. He was weeping. And D.L. Moody asks, him, "What's wrong? Why are you so upset?" He says, I'm grieving the fact that my sin has placed me in this place." And D.L. Moody said, "Thank God. Thank God. There's someone here that finally realizes that sin has got him to this place, and now there's hope for him, right? There's hope for that person because now sin can be repented of, right? Sin can be confessed," and he was able to lead that man to a relationship, to salvation, and a relationship with Jesus Christ. And that man felt guilt. And that's what we want to talk about today. Let me ask you this question. Do you have a proper understanding of guilt? Guilt is an emotional response to wrongdoing. Now there's what I would call normal guilt. All right, we experience normal guilt when we disobey the Bible. Hopefully, when we break God's word, we feel guilty about that, because that's the work of the conscience, our conscience that God has given us, and the Holy Spirit working on that conscience to convict us of sin so that we'll repent and confess that sin. And according to 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we'll confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So sin can be forgiven and can be cleansed away by the blood of Christ. That's normal guilt. However, sometimes if we're not careful, we can suffer from a false guilt. When we feel guilty about certain things, but they're not because of that we've broken God's law, maybe it's not because we've broken government laws, but maybe because some people have placed some expectations on us for one reason or another, and we suffer from this guilt that really isn't from God. And if we're not careful, false guilt, feeling guilty about something that really isn't from God, can cause a lot of problems in our Christian life. It can weigh us down. It can burden us. False guilt can sap the energy out of a Christian. All the desire to live for Christ and to serve Him. False guilt can dampen our hope in the promises of God. And eventually, it could even cause us to draw away from the Lord because we're so defeated and so discouraged. God does not want us to be destroyed, our Christian life and our relationship with Him, by false guilt. And we got to remember that when we were saved, as it says here in this passage, now that we're saved, now that we're before God, we are at peace with God. There's peace. And we're going to see here that as people who are saved and justified, we have been reconciled to a loving and caring God who loves us. And He doesn't want us going around feeling guilty about past sins. He wants us to enjoy our life and enjoy the salvation that He's given us. So what I want to talk about today are three reasons we don't have to experience false guilt, according to this passage. Three reasons why you don't have to be held back by false guilt. And maybe that's something you're suffering from today. If you're suffering here because of guilt, so let's take a look at it. Let's find out what that guilt is and where it's from. Number one, one reason is because we have been saved from wrath. We don't have to go around with false guilt because we have been saved from wrath. Notice it says here, let's go down to verse 9 or verse 8. Go down to verse 8 in our passage and notice what it says here. But God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, much more than. You know, Paul is saying here, isn't it great? I mean, isn't it amazing that Jesus Christ, God would send his own son out of love for us and die for us even while we're sinners. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing. But that's just the start. That's just the start of what God's done. Because he says here in verse 9, much more than. Let's add another amazing thing, right? That's what he's saying. It's amazing what Christ has done. Let's talk about something else that he's done. And it says here in verse 9, now being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Not only did Christ die for us, but because of his shed blood, now we no longer have to face the wrath of God in our future. Our future today is as bright as it will ever be, because we will not have to face the wrath to come. The Bible talks about that, doesn't it? The wrath to come. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. If you got your Bible, why don't you turn there? 1 Thessalonians, don't lose your place in Romans. We're going to come back there. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 10. Notice what the Apostle Paul says about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 10 he says, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. There's wrath coming, folks. Praise God, we don't have to face it. If you're saved and you know Jesus Christ is your Savior, you're not going to experience that wrath. What is that wrath? Well, the Bible tells us over in Revelation, you can go to Revelation and chapter 20, Revelation, the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 20, in verse 11. And we're told about the wrath. We know about the wrath. You know, no one will say, well, I didn't know this was coming. No, the Bible tells us. Wrath is coming. God's wrath upon sin is coming. Notice what it says here in verse 11. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was no place found for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to the works, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's the wrath of God. That's what unsaved people have to look forward to. But praise God, not us. Not the saved. Not those that have been justified by the blood of Christ. That's not for us. We don't have to face that, because we've been delivered. That's what it means there back in Romans chapter 5. We shall be saved. I like that word, saved. It means to be rescued. We've been delivered from that. We are on that way. We are on the road to hell, but we've been delivered from that. And now we are free from that. Thank God we've been saved from that coming judgment. And we don't have to feel guilty. All right? We don't have to feel guilty about that. We don't have to worry about that. You say, well, you know, I deserve that place. I deserve because of my sin. Preacher, you don't know my past. You don't know what I've done. Listen, even though no matter what you've done, regardless of what you've done, because of the blood of Christ, it's been forgiven, and we no longer have to face that. So don't feel guilty about that. Let's rejoice in the fact that we're saved. We've been saved by the blood of Christ. Number two, another reason is because we've been made God's children. We have been made God's children. Just go down to the next verse, verse 10. He continues on, "For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more." Let's take a look at this now. He says here, before we were saved, he says we were actually enemies of God. All right, now why were we enemies? Well, the Bible tells us we were enemies because we opposed God because of our sin and because of our disobedience to the Word of God. We opposed Him. We were contrary to Him. So therefore, we were enemies. The Bible also uses another word to describe that enemy, that hatred that man has towards God, and that is enmity. Enmity. Keep that place there in Romans. Let's go to another passage of Scripture. Go to the book Ephesians, all right? Not too far away in the New Testament. Just go over some books. Go to the book of Ephesians in chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, the same writer, Paul, is saying to the Ephesians, and he mentions about this hatred between God and man, and how this hatred exists. Notice he says here in verse 13, "But now in Christ ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For He is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in His flesh the enmity." There's that word, enmity, in our New Testament. What does that mean? If you had enmity with somebody, that meant that you have ill will towards them. All right? It's not that you just don't like them. You want something bad to happen to them. Okay? That's enmity. And we had that enmity with God. And that divided us. You can't fellowship with someone that you hate. You can't do that. There's a wall of partition, a spiritual wall dividing you. And you can't have fellowship with that type of person. You can't have communion. You can't have a relationship with that type of person. And so that's what we were. We had that enmity with God, that hatred, that ill feeling towards Him. But you know, verse 15, it says here, "Even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in Himself of twain one new man, so making peace." So what did God want? What was God's desire? God's desire was to break down that wall, to put away those ill feelings, and to have a relationship with us. That's what God wanted. God wanted to have communion. He wanted to have a relationship with sinners like us. But that enmity was there. Not because God's a righteous God, He's a holy God, and He has to judge sin, but also because of us. Because of how we felt towards Him. So how are you going to break that down? Well, notice what he says here in verse 16. "And that He might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were far off, and to them that were nigh. For through Him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father." How was that enmity going to be broken down? It was going to be broken down by the cross. By God sending His own flesh and blood, His own Son, Jesus Christ, and the Son of God coming down, paying the price for sin, satisfying God's judgment for sin, and at the same time, putting away those ill feelings, that hatred, so that we could come to God. See, God came to us first, didn't he? God took the first step and came down to bring peace first by dying on the cross. Now, when we accept Christ as Savior, we're taking the step, aren't we? And we're seeking out that fellowship because now the enmity's gone, the hatred's gone, the ill will is gone, because now we recognize Jesus Christ loves us and cares for us and he died for us. How can we have ill will towards God after that? How can I live in disobedience after that, after what God's done for me? And not only that, but because of that, we can have fellowship with God. Notice what it says in verse 19. Now, therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Go back to the Old Testament for just a minute. What happened in the Old Testament? Israel had a special relationship with God, didn't they? They were his children. And the Gentiles were on the outside. They didn't have that favored status. They weren't God's children. They were outside. And so they were considered, as you read the Old Testament, God referred to them as strangers, Gentiles, okay? Outside of that wonderful relationship. And what did God do? How did God make Israel special? What did he do? He allowed them to access him in worship through the temple, through the tabernacle. They had access to God and could fellowship with him through the sacrifices and offerings and all the things that they had. They could approach God to a limited extent. They could worship him. But the Gentiles, not unless they came through Israel. All right? Until they converted to Israel to be an Israelite and they were worshipers of God, then they could have worship. But outside of Israel, they couldn't do that. Well, today, who are we today, the saved? We have a special relationship with God, don't we? Now, are we Israel? Have we been brought into Israel? No, we're not Israel. What are we? All right? We're the children of God, but we're the children of God through the household of God, the church, the body of Christ. That's what we are today. All right? We're the body of Christ, and we are the children of God. You know, children should have a relationship with their parents. Children should have no fear about going to their parents and talking and fellowshipping with them. That should be open. I know sometimes it's not, but that should be open. There should be no division. There should be no enmity there, should there? Sometimes there is. But for us as children of God, there shouldn't be, because God's open. God wants us to come to him. God wants us to fellowship with him. He wants us to commune with him. What are you doing? Sometimes, if we're not careful, guilt. If we're holding, on to guilt for past sins, and we're letting that can interfere with our relationship with the Lord. And that's not what God wants. He doesn't want that. God has opened the way for us to fellowship with him and commune with him on a daily basis through his word and prayer and gathering together to worship as the church. God isn't holding us back. We're holding us back. So don't let that happen. Don't allow this guilt to hold you back from this wonderful, and that's what he says here, much more being reckoned. I'm back in Romans chapter 5, verse 10. It says here, much more. Again, here's another amazing truth, all right? All right, we had one amazing truth, right? We've been saved from the wrath to come. And now he says, here's another amazing truth, being reconciled. We shall be saved by his life. We have a wonderful relationship with our Savior. Don't let false guilt hold you back. Don't let guilt keep you back from that relationship. And then number three, another reason is because we have been pardoned from all sin. We have been pardoned from all sin. Notice it says in verse 11, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So here's another amazing fact, right? Here's another one. He says in verse 11, and not only so. He says, listen, it's amazing. The first two are amazing. But listen to this. That's what he's saying. Listen to this. Not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we now have received the atonement. Even a greater, amazing fact is that each and every one of us, we're no longer guilty of sin. We're no longer guilty. We have received the atonement. What's the atonement? The word atonement means to be restored back to fellowship. To be restored, to be reconciled back in God. Complete reconciliation. Not partial reconciliation, but full and complete reconciliation. What does that look like? Well, go back to the very first of the Bible, the first book of the Bible, Adam and Eve. What did they have? They had complete fellowship and communion with God, physically and spiritually. God came down and communed with them on a regular basis. Well, we have been restored. Now, not 100%, sadly. We still have to deal with the sin nature and all the fall and all the things that we live with today. We have to live with that. But spiritually speaking, we have been reconciled and can have communion, full communion with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We have been pardoned for our sin. And our sin has been paid for. Okay? It's been paid for, and it's been forgiven, and it's been forgotten. So we need to remember that. We have been pardoned and we've been restored to divine favor. Again, if I can talk about Mr. Moody, D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody again. I told a story about a girl from Scotland. And this girl, like some people, they go through rebellion. She rebelled against her parents, and they were godly Christian people, therefore she rebelled against God. And she went her own way, like some do, and left God and left her parents and got into sin. And you know what happens? Like most, you know, sin will take you farther than you want to go, right? It'll cost you more than you want to pay. And she was ready, because of sin, to take her own life. That's what sin had brought her to. To such despair and discouragement, she said, I don't want to live. But she felt, you know, before I take my life, I got to go one more time and see my mother. One more time to see my mother. And so she did. She left. And she came back to her mother where she lived in Scotland, and she knew where she lived. And it was in the middle of the night. You know, she didn't want to be recognized by anybody. And so she came in the middle of the night thinking her mom would be at home and sleeping. She went, opened the gate, went through the courtyard, and went to the house, and surprisingly turned the latch, and it opened. The door opened. The door was unlocked, and she, all of a sudden, this fear came over her, thinking, something's happened to my mom. Why would the door be unlocked? And so she rushed in and she began to cry out, "Mom, Mom, are you here? Mom, are you here?" And the mom woke up and says, "Is that you?" She said, "Yeah, it's me, and I'm worried about you. The door's unlocked. Are you okay?" And mom said, "Listen, ever since you left home, I left that door unlocked, hoping one day you'd come back home and you'd be able to just walk in because I want you back. I want you back." That changed that girl's life. She understood forgiveness. You know, sometimes if we're dealing with guilt, unhealthy guilt, false guilt, it just holds us back, doesn't it? Because listen, when it comes to our Savior, Jesus Christ, the door's open. He's not locked the door. The door is open to complete and wonderful fellowship. It's us that are holding back. It's us that are holding back from coming and opening and coming in fellowship. And if we're not careful, we can allow guilt to hold us back and especially keep us from enjoying the wonderful salvation that God has for us. In conclusion, when we allow false guilt to take away the joy of our salvation, we are denying the sufficiency of Christ's death as the payment for sin. What are some things that could lead to false guilt? Really quickly here, legalism. Legalism. Don't let legalism. What's legalism? You know what legalism is? It's a religion of man-made rules. Be careful of man-made rules. All right, if you're feeling guilt because you're breaking man's rules, I mean, if you're breaking God's rules, that's one thing. I mean, that's good. Good guilt. If you got guilty, you're breaking God's word, then you need to confess that. But if you're breaking man's rules, and it's causing you to live in guilt, all right, I'm talking about in a religious, in the church, okay? I'm not talking about the government laws and things like that. I'm talking about the church. If we're breaking man's rules and not God's rules, and we're having guilt about that, then we need to find out what's going on. We need to find out what's happening. Because even Paul in Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, he says, "Listen, let no man judge you according to meats and drink and holy days." All right, he's referring to Judaism and how Christians were kind of made to feel guilty that they weren't following the law of Moses after they were saved. And Paul is saying, "Listen, we're in the body of Christ. So let's don't let that happen." Perfectionism is another one. Perfectionism. What's perfectionism? Perfectionism is a burden we place upon ourselves. We can become so perfectionist, we can become so obsessed with what our idea of perfection is that when we don't reach that standard, then we begin to feel guilty and we condemn ourselves. And that's not right either. Because let's realize, we're saved, praise the Lord, but we're still sinners, saved by grace. We still make mistakes. We're not perfect. And we'll never be perfect until we get to heaven. So if you have some type of high standard that's, it could be a totally standard that's unachievable because we're just human. We're flesh and blood. Don't do that. Don't do that. And then letter C, trying to please people. Trying to please somebody else. Whether it's at home or in the community or even in church. You know, we may be trying to live to a certain standard, trying to please somebody, trying to please others, trying to get, hopefully they'll think well of us or they'll like us. Listen, let's remember this. It's what God thinks. That's the most important. It's what the Lord thinks about you. That's what we need to remember. And God wants us to live for Him. And, we're not going to make everybody happy. We're not going to please everybody. But we can please the Lord. And that's the most important. Let's please our Savior, Jesus Christ. And most likely, if you're pleasing God and you're pleasing your Savior, then you're probably going to please the people that love and care about the Savior as well, right? That want, you know, we're going to please and be accepted by those who are following Jesus Christ. And that's going to just happen. But let's don't have a false guilt because we can't please everybody. We're not going to. And if you're having guilty feelings, maybe you're dealing with guilt today, well, evaluate where the source of that guilt is. Find out, is this from God? Is there sin in my life? Am I feeling guilt because of a sin that God has told me in His Word and I'm in disobedience? Is this from God? Well, if it is, let's confess it and let's make it right. And let's go on and enjoy our salvation. If it's not from God, if it's from man, then let's let the truth of God set us free. Let's let the truth of God's Word set us free from false guilt so that we can enjoy the salvation God's given us. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank You again for Your Word. We pray that You'd bless us now as we go. And Lord, just enjoy our salvation, the wonderful blessings that we have. And we've looked at three amazing facts of our salvation here today, and what a blessing to know them. And let us enjoy these things and praise You and lift Your name up and glorify You for all that You've given us. So Father, bless us now today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in conclusion,